See, while selecting a topic for my talk, I basically selected infra monitoring using all these tools. But my mentor so pointed it should look glamorous, it should look that it does something. So let me go to, is monitoring, automated and adaptive monitoring, just a glam? Just the two words are a glam, or we actually implemented it? So monitoring, as my talk suggests, is of two types. Automated is, can be of both the types, automated and adaptive. Why we say automated is, in a very general context, automated would mean something, a code or a control system controlling the way something is supposed to work. So in a manner to reduce manual efforts that are implied to it. And automating a monitoring solution would, in all essence of the word, mean the same. So this is something we try to achieve from our chef scripts. I'll be taking chef in detail, slight detail, because there are a lot more tools to be covered after that. And what we do with how we automate our monitoring solution is, we drop in scripts into our machines that need to be monitored, the nodes, and we turn it up in Nagios. We register them to the Nagios server. And why I look at it as an adaptive infrastructure, because everybody would think that automation does it, right? All you need is someone doing the task for you, putting in the script in your machines and them coming up on Nagios. Adaptive would be more in a cloud context, where where the number of your containers or VMs or machines that you're using increase, and it's a more scalable infrastructure. How we do adaptation, how do we do an adaptation sort of, how we achieve the adaptive, you can say, behavior of monitoring is also via Chef, but in a sort of hacky way. We try to drop in scripts and we try to bootstrap the agents so that the right scripts are dropped in the right agent. So say a web server running passenger would have the passenger monitoring scripts and not probably a CI agent monitoring script. So how that goes is we divide our chef cookbooks into the specific role that they're supposed to achieve, and those particular scripts are a part of those cookbooks. So the components that I'm going to be using to achieve an automated and adaptive monitoring solution would be chef, of course, or some sort of, you can say, configuration management. I prefer chef. The next would be Nagios, a simple monitoring tool, but very powerful at that. Has a lot of features that we'll discuss later. And the third is Graphite. Graphite is primarily a plotting tool. All the performance data that Nagios gathers can be just dumped into Graphite to plot graphs, and a lot of analytics can be done in Graphite as well. It gives you a lot of leverage, or it gives you a lot of freedom in what kind of analytics you need to perform, the scaling that you need to do, how you can superimpose graphs on each other. Coming down to Chef, there has been a talk of Chef. I think the very first talk I attended was a Chef talk. And there seemed to be a lot of misconceptions around Chef. There was one question somebody had pointed out, whether Chef can be used to automate development boxes. Well, the answer is yes. If it's a system, it can be automated. It can be configured using Chef or Puppet or whichever CMDB you're trying to use. And the second thing somebody asked was, if I make a change in a cookbook, upload it to my Chef server, would it directly trigger my agents to run the Chef client build or to compile and execute the cookbook? The answer is no, because it's not an SCM. It's a simple client-server infrastructure for your configuration management. Chef primarily works on a client-server setup where all agents are called nodes in Chef topology, and they are registered to the Chef server. Chef has its own DSL, which is written in Ruby, so it becomes really easy for Ruby developers to put in their templates or put in their files. And Chef is very adaptive. We have resources in Chef which adapt themselves to the sort of platform you might be using. So if you just say a package, say httpd install, it would, if you run it on an Ubuntu, in the background it will run an apt-get install. If you run it in say Fedora, or you run it in CentOS, it will do a yum install. The only thing is, you have to be very specific, very clear about the package name you use, because that particular bit, it will pick up literally from what you've written in your code. It also enables you to perform system-specific searches to gather information of your infrastructure. What happens in Chef is your node information is stored as a JSON on your Chef server. So while you think you're just making changes through a Knife plugin, it actually the Chef server actually converts the data into a JSON, and all the key values of that JSON are also the attributes which are searchable, which can be changed, which can be overridden, and can be set to defaults. Chef also allows us to scale our infrastructure, and each new node that has a Chef configuration file, which is also the client RB file, which is stored in etc chef. There is a directory that gets created when you install Chef, and this points to your Chef server URL. So there is a specific key value that says Chef server URL. The moment you configure it to your Chef server, Chef server runs on port 4000 and the web UI runs on 4040. So the moment that is configured, your client gets registered to your Chef server. And all the polling that it will do through that Chef server, all the cookbook that it will run. So yeah, these are the basic points that I just discussed. So now we'll move a little bit towards the Chef server. It's basically a central distribution point for all your cookbooks. If you really want to have a developer workstation, a Git repository is advised for your cookbooks. But just committing your cookbooks into the Git does not mean that you're committing into your Chef server. You have to specifically upload the cookbooks into Chef. This is a slight confusion people have when they start using Chef, which even I had when I started. The components of a Chef server, management and authentication of nodes is another feature. The components of a Chef server are the API service, which is Chef server and Chef server API. These two run on port, it actually runs on port 4000. The management web UI, which is a basic web UI that gives you all your nodes, all your cookbooks, that runs on 4040. There is a Chef Solar, that's our indexer. Let me get back to that slide, I'm sorry. There is a Chef Solar, which is in all essence an indexer that runs on port 8983 and a queuing server. So that's RabbitMQ. So what really happens is, and there's a data store called CouchDB. So what really happens is, when you upload a cookbook, it gets stored on your CouchDB database. And whenever there is a request, the Solar indexes it. And these requests for indexes are stored in your RabbitMQ, your basic queue. And the responses are reverted back to your nodes or your web UI. So CouchDB works on 5984, and it stores the data of all the nodes, all cookbooks, everything that you do on your Chef server will be on the CouchDB. That was a little bit about the Chef server. A Chef client is a node that is registered on the Chef server. It's pretty much the container where everything that your cookbook is supposed to do will do. So your cookbooks are not compiled on your Chef server; they're just stored there. They're executed and compiled on your Chef client. So this is what a client RB looks like. This is where your Chef server URL will come. If your Chef server URL, for the first one, if you haven't configured it, it points to the localhost. If your localhost is also the Chef server, then it starts working for you. But if it's not, you'll get an error where your Chef client run will say that it cannot contact the Chef server. The Chef validator, when a Chef server is created, there are two users that are created by default. One is the Chef validator, one is the Chef web UI, which is the first admin that gets created. Chef validator basically validates, generates a PM file, sort of a private key, public key sort of connection. And for any workstation that you want to create, where you need to have Knife per se, not your management CLI, not your node, you need to have the web UI or any admin key. So if you have one, say, common admin key, you need to share that with the client agent, the Knife agent. So, and this is what a normal node.json looks like. Can everybody see it? Is it visible? So all the keys are in the form of the attributes, name, that will be the host name of the FQDN of your node. The Chef environment, Chef server by default has two environments, none and default. You can also create your environment where you can do version control of your cookbooks. You can freeze the version of a cookbook and upload it to the environment. And this is a node that we had created where we had specified a Java version, Java home, Go for all uses. Because I'm from ThoughtWorks, Go is our CI henceforth. And of course, Nagios, because we are going to be doing a bit of monitoring later. So we need to configure Nagios. So this is just a test. This is just a JSON that I'm trying to show you, where all these attributes can be the NRP, the Nagios, Go. All these attributes can be defined, and they can be defaulted to or overridden. So now we'll come to the next part. That's the Chef cookbooks. These are the basic units of distribution in Chef, and all the magic that you want on your agents is configured in them. Chef cookbook can contain executes resources. Yeah, it can contain all these files, the attributes like I mentioned. We'll have a default.rb file where you'll be overriding, where you'll write your attributes that you need to override, or the attributes that you need to set as defaults. There's something like libraries that you can also configure in your cookbooks. Say if specifically you want to write an LWRP, lightweight resource and provider. Something, there was another question in the previous talk where somebody had asked if I have my custom installer, say nothing like Yum, or if I write my custom installer. Chef has some inbuilt cookbooks, the Opscode repository, so one of them is app. So things like LWRP you can configure yourself, where you would be using more of libraries and providers and resources. And the only problem there is that particular cookbook, if you're using it along with your cookbook that you want, should install according to your installer, has to be loaded on your Chef server, has to be part of the role that you're applying to the node. You can't say my cookbook needs to use that particular cookbook, but you don't have that cookbook listed in your routers. It will not run otherwise. Then we have something like files. Files is static content that you need to plant in your node. Essentially static files. Templates would be, templates are something that are, they're primarily ERB files. And dynamically, if you want to load some content into your host. Now this is what exactly makes our system adaptive, because how we try to, in the coming slides, I'll try to show you how we pull the nodes from our Chef server and try to put it in the Nagios configuration file. So what really happens in templates is during runtime, it tries to pull the Chef server with any new node that has been added. And in the templates, if you pass a variable, you can pull it through as an array or as a hash and put those values and insert those values. So your configuration files are updated. Recipes are the basic content where we write our resources, what we need to exactly do, and how files or attributes are actually set and where they need to be set. You may have nothing in your cookbook, but you need to have one recipe that does. That may not do anything, but it has to have a default recipe. There is a metadata that basically defines who's written it, the maintainer, and your email IDs, and your licensing, your version. So your version control happens here in metadata. Also, if you've included any cookbooks in your recipes, you have to put in a depends clause here. Otherwise, standard dictates you need to do it. Then we have something like definitions. Definitions also are sort of, you can say, reusable collections that you may want to use in your cookbooks. This is how a cookbook would really look like when you shoot a command with a knife, with say knife cookbook create. So it will by default give you all these files. You may want to use them, you may not want to use them, the directories, it's up to you. When you upload a cookbook to a Chef server, any directory that's empty will not get uploaded. Whatever content is there, only that will get uploaded. You need to say that again.
In the recipes, can I put some executable paths or some scripts that I have to run as a part of configuration? Maybe I need to add my amounts on a particular client,
Yeah. So you have resources in your recipes that do that. We have something like an execute command where, but that's not an idempotent resource. But basically, what you need a CMDB configuration management system would be, because you need things to be idempotent. So specifically for execute, you need to shoot a command, and that command will be run each time the Chef client runs. So if you have a cron job, it will keep running each time. It won't poll whether the command has already taken effect or not. You need to put a small test clause that can be done with conditional statements like not if or if only. So you can do that. In fact, if you want to run scripts, you can actually plant the script somewhere and run it through your Chef saying execute this script. And you can change the mode of that script to executable or however you want. So it's pretty flexible. That way you can do a lot with Well, his question was if I have to run a script, I think, through a recipe, how would you achieve that? So now after cookbooks we come to something like a role. Now role basically helps us in setting up the you know, basically making the functionality of the system that we are configuring more verbose. So a role is essentially a collection of cookbooks, and in the run list of the role you can actually list down all the collections, all the cookbooks. Now the run list includes the cookbooks that are required to create the role. Say you want to set up a web server. Now a web server may not necessarily, it's not just passenger that you need on it. You might need HTTP, or you might need you know, Ruby to run some scripts. You might need Python or Java, a certain specific version of Java for your scripts. All that, you can have specific cookbooks for specific actions. Say installing Java, have a Java cookbook. For passenger, have a passenger cookbook, and list all this in one role. So when the run list of the role is written, you add all these cookbooks in sequence of which they're run. If you mess up the sequence, it basically Chef runs everything sequentially. So it will pull the role cookbook sequentially, run the cookbook sequentially. Within the cookbook, the resources that you've written down will be run sequentially. So if you write a resource, say changing the mode of a file, and the file is being copied at a later stage, so you'll have an error, because actually on that system the file is not there, right? So you need to be very careful about your sequence. Now a typical role would look like this, where you describe, this is a Ruby file. You can create roles by knife plugin, or you can have a Ruby file or have it on your Git and do a knife role from file. All these commands I won't be discussing too much, because there's a whole list of knife commands that you can read from the Opscode webpage. The description is basically what it needs to do. This goes in the Chef server. The run list is what all cookbooks that you're adding and how they're going to be run. Environment run list. Now we discussed earlier that Chef helps you create environments. Now based on the environment that you're using, it will use what cookbook it is going to run on that particular mode. Default attributes would be the attributes that will be defaulted to. Override would be if anything, for Max children, if my node already by default loads 100, this will override it to 50. This will override, so basically Max children would be overwritten to anything unless it is changed here on your cookbook. Next we'll come to monitoring. Nagios is a very effective monitoring tool, which provides, among a lot of other features, it provides the ability for you to monitor your infrastructure. It also provides you a pretty decent dashboard where you can see all the services that you're monitoring, the status of the services, and it keeps updating itself as and when a polling is triggered. So if it's a local system that you're monitoring, if you're monitoring the Nagios server itself, you may not need any extra plugin. But if you're monitoring a remote system, you would need a plugin called NRP. Nagios has a lot of plugins that it uses to poll. So basically it's just a monitoring server which polls it's all the nodes that are configured towards it through NRP. That's the remote, it's the Nagios remote something, I forget the B, executor, plugin executor, yeah. It also does an outage detection on custom, and it provides you custom warnings and custom critical levels that you can set up. So for each Nagios built-in plugins, you will have a dash W and dash C, you can plugins where you can set up the range, or you can set up the particular level of warning and criticality. So accordingly, when Nagios plugins return the value, it will either be red for critical, it will either be orange for unknown, yellow for warning, and green for everything is okay. You can also configure Nagios to send out alert messages through emails, SMS, pager, and there's something like problem acknowledgement for known issues. If you know that my particular machine is going to come down at this time, and it comes down, sends in an email to everybody, you can do a acknowledgement, push in a, you can say status message, or you can push in a commit message where you say that, you know, this is a known message and this is what I'm doing about it. It will be fixed soon. So everybody will be alerted that this is the acknowledgement that we've received, and so people don't have to go out of their way to, you know, switch into their network again and figure out what's going wrong. It also provides something like alert escalations, which need to be configured in your Nagios setup. So that's not something that I'm going to be discussing in too much detail, alert escalation. So when we talk about Nagios configuration, basically it derives all its configuration from text files, which are stored in etc Nagios directory. The primary config file is nagios.cfg file, and specific configuration is loaded under all these files. How they're different from each other is commands will only store the commands that you're going to run through your plugins. Say you write a custom plugin. So just writing a custom plugin would not ensure Nagios running that particular command to test your remote machine. You would need to configure it here. Then contacts are configured for alert messaging. Whosoever you want to should be contacted for whatever alerts should be put in contacts. You can also configure contact groups where you can add members that you've already added as contacts in your contacts or CFP. I'll show you a sample contacts file. Hosts is every host that should be tested or that should be monitored by the Nagios is set up in the host file. Now, what I've tried to use is use the host file as a template where each time it will pull from the chef server all the nodes that have currently registered to the chef and have the Nagios cookbook, and it will run, it will add it to the host file. So essentially, in all contexts, that host is supposed to be monitored by your Nagios server. The fourth file is the localhost file. Localhost is its own file that it has the data of its own configuration, the IP, the name. Basically, it's a host file, but here it has the data for itself. Services is the services that you're going to be monitoring per host. So every host that you add, that particular host has to be configured with every service that you're adding next. So all this can be configured through templates, through 4 lines of code, which will be pulled dynamically, and it turns the script into like 100 lines based on how many nodes that you have. There is also something like time periods, where you might want to set up time periods where of polling, or how much time do you want the Nagios to spend in contacting the server nodes and getting back the responses. And how long will it work? Should it work 24/7? Should it only work weekdays, or should it only work weekends? All that can be set up in your time periods. And there is something like templates, basic templates that you need to set up. Templates are essentially Nagios gives you a node template, that's a generic node, that's a Linux server template, where it defines 4 or 5 lines of code where whatever you need to do in it. If there is some particular functionality that you want to associate with every node, you may want to define it here rather than defining it in the host file. Then you have something like a generic service. Whatever a service needs, the time periods, the contact groups and everything is configured in the generic service. And there's something like a generic command, generic contact. So you can also configure templates on your own. Whatever flows through the definition of that particular object can be configured in your templates file. And then going back to your host or commands, you can just use a use key and apply that template with it. I'll show you an example of that. Now coming here to templates. So if this is a contact that I've defined, right? There is a template that says generic contact. So this particular template is being used. And for host, if you can see, Linux server is the template name. And for service, I don't think it's the generic service. So all these commands are specified for each and every host. They will hold true for each and every host. So you can see it defines the notification period, it defines the check period, it defines the interval. These process performance data, this part comes when it pulls in all the performance data from your nodes. Your flap detection, flapping basically how much time does that does a particular service take to come up, or is it flapping coming up and down. There are a lot of other things that you can configure in this. Say you want to add contact groups, say you want to add another person, you can say contact and you can add the name of that person. Right, so this will flow through your node definition. Coming to NRP, NRP is the Nagios remote plugin executor. So what it does is it will retrieve the data of your remote services. It consists of I think there's a typo there. It's not the chef, it's the check NRP plugin that is used. When you download the NRP plugins, the check NRP plugin is actually the one that pulls all the remote machines and pulls in the data. If you just shoot the check NRP dash capital H and the host name that your Nagios server is monitoring, it will give you the version of NRP. That basically shows that your NRP is working fine. Along with that, after the host, if you shoot a command by using dash C and you give the command name that you specified in the commands.cfg, that command will be shot against your node or your the remote host that your Nagios server is monitoring, and it will retrieve the data. If that particular plugin is not planted in your remote server, it will say that I cannot find that command file. So you need to be very specific when you're configuring Nagios and NRP all the plugins that you want your Nagios to query your nodes against have to be in the user lib Nagios plugins directory, or you may specify the directory on your own. And you have to give the, if you specify a directory on your own, you may want to give the absolute path for that particular. So yeah, the configuration file is stored at EDC NRP. So this is what basically happens. Within the Chef server, you have the Check NRP plugin, which pulls the NRP service in and all these plugins that are there in your remote machines. And it will retrieve the data and give it to you. So why we talk about retrieving data is, we will throw the data into graphite to plot. Or you may have a plugin for Nagios, which is called the PNP for Nagios, which plots all the graphs for you. This is a sample plugin that just queries the RAM of the system, and it puts in levels of alerts. So there are four return values that Nagios will identify. The first exit value 0 means everything is going fine, and your Nagios output would be green. If the exit value is 1, it implies warning. So this is decided. So while you're writing your Nagios plugins, make sure that your exit values coincide with the message that you want the Nagios server to have. So exit value 1 implies that it's a warning, that you're in the warning level. That you will decide through all these if clauses will decide which level it is at. Right? Exit value 4 implies that it's an unknown state, that it's unable to do what it wants to do. And exit value 3 means it's critical. Then while setting up a sample plugin that you've created, first you will drop that plugin file into the node that you want to monitor, in the user's lib64 if it's a 64-bit server, or lib Nagios plugins. And in the nrp.config, you'll either include the directory where your plugins might be, or you may want to write in the plugins here itself, you know, include the plugins niche. And if you want a custom.cfg, this is where the command would be written. But this command has to come in your Nagios commands.cfg file. So there has to be a sync between your NRP plugins and your Nagios server. So all the commands need to be specified in the commands.cfg file. All the services that you're monitoring need to be specified in the services.cfg file. And the command also, if there's a custom command, it also needs to be in your Nagios configuration. Either it can be in nrp.d, or it can be a line link at the end of this file. So now if we do a sample configuration of our Nagios server, so this is where I'll define in the commands.cfg, I'll define my command, and I'll define what exactly it is supposed to do. It will go to the user's plugins directory, pick up this file, that's my plugin file, pull it against the host address. Host address it will take up from the cookbook that we're using, because we're dynamically planting all the hosts. The second thing that we need to do is, now we've specified the command, the second thing would be specifying the service. The service would explain exactly what it needs to do. It will run check NRP, and the exclamation basically means after check NRP, this is the command that needs to be run. So the name of this command has to tally with the name of the command here, and the name of the command that has been given in the nrp.config file. Right? And all this is notification period, notification intervals, all this can be set up. So yeah, now when we talk about a host, in my cookbook, my host will be configured this way. This will be my node FQDN, and alias can be anything. It depends on what you want to write there. The address would be the node IP address. Why I haven't mentioned any values here is because in my chef, going ahead, there will be a cookbook. I'll show you a cookbook where in my chef, I'm going to pull this data dynamically. This is the time periods file. This is how we'll define the time period depending on what days of, you know, normal work hours, what will you define it as. And this is a sample contact that I would like to create. It pulls in the template for generic contact, and this is a contact group. This also goes in my contacts.cfg. Sorry?
Let's say I want to monitor every hour. How much is the RAM?
Yeah. not in time periods, when you go to the host definition, when we check the generic host, right, there was a check interval, right? There you can configure it, or you can put it specifically here if you don't want it there. If for one particular service you want it called every hour, you can put it here. So yeah, now how do we do Chef and Nagios together? So the first setup would be my default.rb, that's my default file. This is just the part where it will load. The first thing we need to do is a package Nagios install, right? That can be referred from anywhere. The most important part here is the notes from Solr. Now, this is the search ability that I was talking about earlier. You can directly push in a search to the notes, that all the notes. So basically *:* would be all my notes. What the star first means is the attribute that I'm searching for and the value that I'm searching for. This would give me every node that is registered to my Chef server. Go agents, now this is a specific, we were trying to set up host groups. So this will specifically search nodes where the recipe for Go agent is applied, or where the recipe with the name Go agent or that particular string appears. So now here what happens is, so all these templates from my templates directory in my cookbook, it will pick up each and every object. It will give all these attributes, the owner, the group, the node. Now when I say variables and I'm passing these variables into my template, when this particular block of code is executed, it will pick up the nodes from Solr as an array that I've pulled in here, and for each particular element it will create an entry. So if my host file basic looks like this, and here is what I'm gonna put in my data. Now since every node is a JSON, I can easily pick up the node value, and whatever attribute I need should be assigned here. So when this is executed in the actual node, you'll be able to see the node name, you'll be able to see the node FKDN and the IP address that you've set for that node. So this will dynamically populate your host file, and based on how many ever servers or nodes that are being attached to your Chef server or configured with your Chef server will appear here. Say I add two more nodes, and if my cron job or any scheduler that I've run will run Chef, will run this particular cookbook on my Nagios server, say every 30 minutes. So every 30 minutes if I add a new object, it will appear in my Nagios configuration, in my Nagios web UI, and all the services would be, they'd be started to monitor. So, and also, as I mentioned earlier, your services have to be per node, per service per node. So this will also pull in from the nodes. It will pull the service name that I'm trying to specify here, that's the checkram service. And for every node that it picks up, it will add this service check. So every time it will check that, so for every node that I'm pulling in my chef, it will check this particular service. If I do not add the host, add the host with this service name, that host will not be checked against the service. So it is very particular, whatever host you want should be checked against whatever service should appear here in your services.cft file. Coming to host config, now if I had two hosts in my server, running that cookbook will populate my host.cfg like this. It will populate two hosts and it will populate the two IPs of that host, however I had put it dynamically. This is not what I had put it in my cookbook, it's not static, so it got populated. If I were to add another host, and if I ran the chef client again on my Nagios server, I'll have another entry because it's pulling from the chef server. All my nodes while bootstrapping are getting bootstrapped to my chef server. So that's something that has to be kept in mind, that the node has to be registered to the chef server for you to achieve this. And my service would look like this. So per node, my services are configured. It's the same service doing exactly the same thing, but the node name, host name changes. We'll move a little bit towards Graphite. The only, you can say, functionality of Graphite that we've really exploited is just the graphing part of it. It does a real-time graphing. The front end is a web app. You can see the output through a web app. And the back end is a storage application that's Carbon. It is basically a Python application, and it has three processes that are run in a pipeline. One is Carbon Agent, Carbon Cache, and Carbon Persistent. So what essentially happens here is all the agents contact the Carbon, and they send their data, and it becomes Carbon's job to evaluate that data for real-time graphing. The primary process that is run is the carbonagent.py. It starts up two other processes in pipeline, that's the Carbon Cache and Carbon Persistent. when agents connect to the Carbon server, the Carbon agent accepts the connection request and all the data that is formatted according to Graphite. How that formatting is done will be in the next part. And basically, it forwards the entire data to the Carbon Chef, Carbon Cache for caching, where it groups the data points based on their associated metric. So there's a lot of things that happen in the Carbon part. And the Carbon Cache basically feeds all these data points to the persister, which then reads and writes them to the disk as using Whisper. That's an RRD, that's a round robin database tool. So essentially what happens is it just pulls in all your data and puts it up on a graph. It just beautifies it. Now how do we configure all of them together? So the first thing we do is, I don't think this is visible, I'll show you. So this is my Nagios cookbook, right? Nagios server cookbook. Now the first thing that we need to do is we need to add the formatted data into our Nagios configuration file. So that appears in my templates. So this part, I don't think it's visible. Is it visible?
No.
Can you guys see this? What? I'll have to start it again. Won't change on its own. So wait. Now can you see it? Visible. It's a little messed up because that's the way it is. What we are using here is we are using Graphios, which has been written by Sean Sterling. It is basically, you can put it in a way, it is a service that will help you in getting all your data from the Nagios server and pushing it into the Carbon, Now what this does is it specifies your performance data file and it specifies the way it is supposed to be passed. So all this is actually the format that goes with it. And all the performance data that needs to go, right? So the next thing that we need to configure are these two commands, which is again not visible. This comes under my graphios.cfg. Either I can put it here or I can put it in my commands.cfg. It really doesn't matter because if I'm putting it as a separate file, graphios.cfg, it will come under my, if I were to go back to nagios.cfg, there is, so there is something like cfg underscore file here. This particular tab, so you need to include all the files that you're going to be using in your Nagios server. So my graphios.cfg file would be included here if I am putting it as a separate file altogether. So these are my two commands that need to be put in. So these are the performance host and the performance service. Now these commands will particularly come under each host and service that I define. The third thing that we need to do is with every host that we are adding, we need to have a Graphios. You can have a Graphite prefix if you want. It just puts in the data in a beautiful way. You can say Nagios monitoring, and how it appears is the prefix Nagios monitor. It will give you a dot, then your host name, dot the Graphite postfix. The Graphite postfix is decided by your services. So the postfix is defined in your services. What it means is my Nagios is monitoring this particular node with this and checking this particular service. So for every service, this bit will change. So there's only one line of code that is added in my host, in my service file in the services.cfg. One line of code that is added in my host.cfg, and these couple of lines here. this is basically Sean Sterling's page. He has an elaborate readme and an elaborate installation advice. So you can go through it and you can configure Grapios. It's pretty simple. All these commands are mentioned in his readme. All his configurations are mentioned in his readme. So basically, well, client, so couldn't show you the names. So this is how it, my Nagios would actually look like. Why it's all green as well, everything is okay in our infrastructure. And all these services are that are being monitored. So can you guys see this? Is it visible? No? Still not visible, is it? I don't know what much to do about this. Anyway, all these services are being monitored. Well, the last service here is check Go server because I can see it. So this particular VM is my Go server. So it's monitoring my CI server, but the next VM is my web server. So it's not monitoring Go anymore here or the CI, it's monitoring passenger here. And the next is my Go agent, so it will monitor my Go agent. So depending upon what all cookbooks that you're writing, you can easily write a custom plugin and just drop it to your to your plugins directory and have it configured in your Nagios server cookbook. So when it comes to, you know, writing the cookbook, the process that you'll follow is write a plugin in your custom cookbook, go to your Nagios server cookbook, upload the command, the service, and get it running, chef client, and that will populate it here. And this is how my graphite would look. This is basically an interpolation of a lot of data. So my graph would either be one graph, this is two, three graphs together, and you can add color to it. You can do a lot of analytics with it. So yeah, that's what graphite helps you. What? Graphite is open source, Graphios is open source, everything is open source. So yeah, that's all that I had to say about this. So any questions are welcome. I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Graphite DSL? No, we are just passing the commands through. We are not essentially going into the graphite and doing anything. We're using Graphios, which is sort of a wrapper, you can say. Yeah. Yeah. I think we use it while we are passing the data from Nagios to Graphite. Or that can also be done online while you're looking at the map or looking at the graph if you don't see it well. So we generally try to alter the graph in real time while looking at it. We're still to explore that part of it. We haven't really. Thanks so much. We'll try to explore. Anything else? It works on TCP, support based. So AMQP is only trans for the RabbitMQ part. So I guess in the services configuration you can identify the port and maybe pull the data through it. There may be specific documentation on this, which we haven't really come across such a problem yet. Thanks so much.